This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we have someone new with us who has never been on the show before. Diana Walsh Pasulka is with us with her new and explosive book, American Cosmic UFOs, Religion, and Technology. A very interesting combination. We're going to ask Diana about that. Let me tell you about Diana. She's a professor of religious studies at the University of North Carolina. She's chair of the Department of Philosophy and Religion. Currently, her research efforts focus on supernatural belief and practice and its connection to digital environments. She has a long list of writings and papers and so on and so forth, a very accomplished academic. Welcome to Dreamland, Diana.
Thank you so much, Whitley. I'm happy to be here.
Okay. Well, that introduction I just read does not suggest any interest in UFOs. And yet you have written the most explosive book on this subject in 10 years, at least.
So, thanks.
Okay. So the first question out of the box is, why in the world did you end up in this really sort of peculiar space of UFO research?
Right. That's a very good question. And it feels very, very natural to me. But in 2012, basically the whole year, I was walking around in a daze thinking the same thing. But it actually comes naturally from my study of religion. And within my field of religious studies, we do study things that are quote unquote odd, weird, you know, we study people walking on water and, you know, the beliefs of people in things like supernatural beings and supernatural beliefs. So I finished writing this book about purgatory, which is a Catholic belief, a Catholic dogma. And it's about ideas of, you know, where do souls go when they die? And they're not, say, good enough to get into heaven. Well, there's this place called purgatory. And Catholics believed in it and did devotions to souls in purgatory for about 1500 years, and then this belief went away, or not the belief, but the practices associated with it. And so I had done about 10 years to do the research for that book. And I did this, and I came up with a lot of what are aerial phenomena, shining beings, examples of these things from reports, historical reports. And I kept a log of these reports. And it was growing and growing and growing. And I honestly didn't know what to think about them. And, you know, you have aerial phenomena, things that come down from the sky, luminous beings from the sky that zap people with, you know, these rays and things like that. And I was thinking, what is this? And so I showed it to a friend of mine. And my friend said, wow, this looks a lot like Steven Spielberg films, you know, UFOs and that type of thing. And I thought, well, that's crazy. And I actually told him, oh, you're crazy. But, of course, coincidentally, the next week, I attended a conference in my town. It was a UFO conference that I would have never attended, but my curiosity was piqued, and so I went to the conference, and I recognized a lot of what was in the log I was keeping. And so that's how my research started. It naturally came from my research in Catholic history and Catholic studies. And once I really got into the research, it got a lot weirder and a lot more interesting. And I began my book, and my book was started in 2012, and here it's 2019, and it's just being published.
It's also one of the most extraordinary UFO books ever published, and in part that's because of the fact that you have access to two people named in the book as James and Tyler, who have really deep inside knowledge. They're the real deal. Now, I wanted to ask you, first, before we go into exactly what they told you and what that all means, I want to ask you how you met first. Let's ask you about James, or either one, whichever you wanted to say first.
Sure. Okay. So I think the first thing that needs to be said about these two people is that I did not seek out to meet them. I didn't seek them out. And I do agree that they both have very specific knowledge about the phenomena, and I didn't even know people like this existed. So one of the themes of my book is this idea of invisibility or the invisible. And I'm riffing off of two things. One is The Invisible College of Jacques Vallée and Alan Hynek, you know, but I'm also bringing in the idea from this 1990s movie called Fight Club, which is that there's this agenda, not agenda, that's the wrong word actually to use, but there's a code. It's a code of ethics within this new type of invisible college. And we don't talk about it. Okay, so the first rule of Fight Club, don't talk about Fight Club. Second rule, don't talk. So this...
Those rules certainly apply to this phenomenon.
It really does. I mean, you know, so that was something that first is not the code of ethics that academics abide by, right? So it was very different from the cultures in which I already existed. And I was hesitant, really. None of this ever happened when I was studying Catholic history. So I never ran into people like James or Tyler. I never had people seek me out. I never ran into any kind of things that needed to be kept silent and secret. You know, this was never the case. So I really had to adjust in that first year, 2 years, really. I really had to adjust to the new terrain. And actually, people like you helped me out because, you know, you're an author and you're a mainstream author. And you're also within a group of people, like, you know, people like James and Tyler as well. So, you know, I met you, I met Jacques Vallée, I met Jeff Kripal, and I met people who were able to help me understand the new terrain. And again, I didn't seek out to meet you either. You know, we just met each other. And this is how my research progressed. And it was surprising and strange and eye-opening. And so, yes, I did meet James. Okay, so you asked about how did I meet James. At this point, I was in with a group of academics who were interested in the topic of belief in UFOs, which is not so strange in my field. So as I said before, we do study belief, you know, we study beliefs and religious practices and things like that. So it's very obvious that a lot of people believe in UFOs. And so this is something that is ripe for study in my field. So there were a group of academics in my field who wanted to invite other people who studied UFOs from different fields, and there aren't a lot of them. And there aren't a lot of them because of what I call the John Mack effect, which is that, you know, John Mack was a Harvard researcher who had won a Pulitzer Prize, but decided to study people who believed in UFOs too. And this was in the 1980s. And he was actually, and I believe you knew Mack, right?
Oh, yes, I knew him well. We were good friends.
That's right. And you know exactly what happened to him. So he was investigated by his own university, Harvard University, for studying, you know, doing an innocent study with correct research protocols on people who believed in UFOs. He found that they were not delusional, right? And so, you know, but his career was deep, right? So, I mean, he had
terrifying.
An incredibly, yeah.
Yeah, he called me up one morning and said, Whitley, I think I'm going to be thrown out of Harvard and lose my license. So, yeah, but go ahead.
Wow. Yeah, so that's the effect. It's chilling. It's a chilling effect on academics. So we, you know, in my field, though, we can study this kind of stuff because that's what we do. So Jeff Kripal and I were organizing a group of academics, and it was suggested that we talk to this person, James. And this is a person who was at a top university and was in the midst of studying the topic. And this person was incredible, an incredible academic with incredible credentials. And we just assumed that he would say no and, you know, think, no, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to. First, we're humanities people, and this was a scientist. And that's when, you know, we thought, oh, he's not going to talk to us. What do we have to offer him? But we invited him, and he came, and he turned out to be one of the most unpretentious, refreshing, brilliant academics I've ever met. Just a wonderful, you know, kind of a hero in my book in terms of how hard he works, lives for his job, and is incredibly intelligent, brilliant, in fact, and on the cutting edge and immersed and obsessed with the study of the phenomena. So that's how I met him. We invited him to a conference and he came. And he really blew our minds. I write about it in the book in chapter 2 about what he presented at the conference and how a lot of the people who were, you know, not believers they were presented with the research that he did, and it was really hard to say, this guy's wrong, right? None of us had the ability to argue with him, and nor would we want to, because he argues so well.
You're not going to beat him.
No one is.
No one.
And so, so that's what happened. That's how I met James. And I had met Tyler before I met James, but I decided that I'd introduce them. Should I discuss how I met Tyler also?
Yeah, why don't you? Because, folks, when you read the book, you're fine. These two people are real. They are actually insiders. It's quite real. And therefore, what she learned from them is also real. And we'll talk about all of that over the course of the show. But, yeah, first tell us about how you met Tyler. But before you do that, my dear free Dreamlanders, listen to these announcements.
They are found deep in a dying jungle, 6 infants. They aren't apes. They aren't human either, not quite. So what are they? When they are spirited off to the United States, an incredible discovery is made. They are as smart as us, but not us, not human. The company that found them wants to buy and sell them as the most valuable animals on Earth, brilliant workers who need not be paid. Somebody has to stop this travesty, and that's where primatologist Beth Cook comes in. But can she stand up to the power and wealth that seeks to exploit them? Find out in Whitley Strieber's first standalone science fiction novel in 7 years. New. Get it on Amazon as an ebook or paperback.
You've probably heard the music for years. It's the theme song for Dreamland. But you may not know the name of the piece, The O of Pleasure. Or the name of the composer, Ray Lynch. Ray Lynch is a 3-time Billboard Award winner. Ray is also the composer of the platinum album, Deep Breakfast. Pandora calls Ray one of the most influential artists in New Age pop and adult alternative circles.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen, without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
We're back. We're talking to Diana Walsh Pasulka. Her new book, American Cosmic, UFOs, Religion, and Technology. I would submit that it's probably one of the most important books to have been written on this subject in at least 10 years and maybe more. And so it's a very, very exciting to talk to her. You can learn more about American Cosmic at AmericanCosmic.com, or you can buy it through our website, which would be lovely because we get a little bit of that if you do buy it from Amazon by clicking on it from unknowncountry.com. Now, before we stopped, Diana, I was going to ask you about Tyler, the other truly remarkable individual in this book that you met and knew.
Yes. So I had actually, I had heard about Tyler before I met him, and he is a scientist. And he works he's affiliated with the space program in various capacities, working on the space shuttle and that type of thing, and or what, you know, the used to be space shuttle program. And he is a very fascinating, what people call technopreneur, you know, in biotechnology. And so I'd heard about Tyler, but I didn't really want to meet him. And part of the reason I didn't want to meet him was I was a little suspicious about him, because actually he wanted to meet me and he was interested in my research. And I did have people who were interested in my research who were, you know, I would get the random scientists working with various people who study the phenomena, and they would want, you know, they would have read something I'd written about angels or something, and they were really interested in it. And I thought that was odd. And I didn't quite get the connection, you know, then I did, now I do, but I didn't get the connection. I just thought it was strange and I was suspicious of it. Plus I am, I have to say, I'm just a boring professor of religious studies.
Well, I have to differ with you there. I've read the book on purgatory and I've also seen you lecture, and you are very, very dynamic. Nobody's going to not listen. And this is so not a boring professor of religious studies, but go ahead.
Well, I was living what one would call, you know, just a normal life. And I didn't really want to complicate it. And I could just tell that meeting Tyler, you know, and getting into this topic was really going to complicate things. And it did, but in a really amazing way, completely unanticipated. But so I did meet Tyler, actually, and I write about that in the book. So we had actually had an email correspondence before we actually met. And he said, well, I'm going to be around, you know, I was going to go to Atlanta to this conference, and he was actually going to be around that area. And it was a conference for people who study religion. Jeff Kripal was going to be there as well. And he's a friend of mine and a colleague. And I said, Jeff, please meet this person with me, because I don't know quite what to think about this person. I'm a little suspicious. And so Jeff and I went to lunch with him, and he turned out to be an incredibly smart, charismatic, charming person, fascinating. And Jeff was completely taken with him and even invited him back to Houston. And I was thinking, Jeff, what are you doing? You know, you're supposed to be suspicious like me. But he wasn't at all. So then the next step was Tyler asked me if I wanted to go to the crash site in New Mexico, one of several, apparently. And it wasn't Roswell. And if I went, I would have to agree to be blindfolded to go. And then, so I wouldn't know where I was. And then I was going to have, you know, I was going to be able to see, you know, he said, you have a lot of historical evidence of the phenomena, but now don't you want to have physical evidence? And I said, well, yeah, I do want to have physical evidence, but, I really didn't believe that I'd have, you know, I just, you know, in religious studies, we don't weigh in on a belief of yes or no, actually. We kind of keep our minds open. And so I was approaching this topic exactly that way. And so but again, even though now I had met him, I still didn't really want to go to New Mexico and be blindfolded and taken on this trip. So I suggested that we take someone else. And so it ended up being James, the scientist, who's obsessed with the topic. And I knew that Tyler would at first not agree to James, but then Google him and figure out that there's no better person than James to take. And that's exactly what happened. So after a few days, I told James about it, and James was busy. And we waited. I said, we just need to wait now. And we waited. And, you know, I knew that as soon as they met, that they would be off and running working together, because they were both highly skilled, highly creative, successful scientists. And they did, in fact, they worked together. And so we went, and James and I were blindfolded, and we were taken to the crash site. And I was going as a person who they knew I wasn't a believer. They're both believers. And so I was going as a person who was writing about the topic of belief in the phenomena. And they knew that, I knew that. So we went under those auspices. And so we went out there, and it was quite, I think I may have mentioned this, but maybe not. When I got there, the place itself was really eerie in a very beautiful, strange way. And I almost felt as if I had to write about it as its own character in the book. I mean, I honestly felt that I was being watched out there, that the place itself had a presence or an aura. Things happened, like I saw this giant rainbow, and I mean, there were just a lot of things that happened that were really beautiful. And I felt like I entered a place that truly was the land of enchantment, actually. And that's the whole, that feeling permeated our trip. And we did find parts as well. We had metal detectors that were adjusted to a certain, I'm not a scientist, and I'm actually not, a material scientist, so I don't know, but they were adjusted, and we were able to find these. It took us all day. We found some parts, and that's what happened.
Now, that site is a really strange place for more than one reason. As you bring up in the book, there is another event that happened in that area, not on that exact site, I would assume, but in this area, which is the story of Sister Maria Fernandez Coronel, which you can tell us if you will, because it's a remarkable story. And folks, when you think about the fact that how Diana just described the feeling at the crash site, and then this extraordinary historical event plays a part in this. And when we get back, Free Dreamlanders, you're going to find out more.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle. It's available in paperback. And there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to the Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
We're talking to Diana Walsh Pasulka. Her new book, American Cosmic, UFOs, Religion, and Technology. A remarkable book. You can learn more about it at americancosmic.com, but it's a real brain bender. Now, I would like to go, if you to set the scene, take us back to the past and tell us what happened in that area.
Sure. So this is something that I knew from my studies of Catholic history and people who live in New Mexico and Arizona know this too from their own history, the history of the state. That and the colonial era, that when Spain colonized the area, part of the history of their colonialization was the story of the Blue Lady. And the Blue Lady was a woman who was a real nun who lived in the 1600s in Spain and believed that she would fly on the wings of angels to the New World, and she would basically meet indigenous Americans and evangelize them. And there were so basically this is written into the history of, you can't avoid it. If you know, there are still churches dedicated to her there. She's, you know, there's a canonization process going on for her. So whether or not she really did this, this is this is what we would call in my field sacred history. This is real sacred history that's American history. And I encountered it. I've learned about her. I'm from California. So my grandparents lived in Arizona. So, you know, there was already this woman who was doing this. Now, I didn't think about her one bit, of course, when I was out there. It never occurred to me to think about her. And in fact, I finished my book and I turned my book, that manuscript, into my editor. And after that, I was scheduled to go to the Vatican, and I'd been asked to go to the Vatican to look at the canonization and trial records of one saint, Joseph of Cupertino, and then her, Mary of Agreda. She's not a saint yet. And look at their trial records and at the Vatican Secret Archive. And this was unrelated to my book.
And now, you've actually worked in the Vatican Secret Archive.
Yes, yes. So you need special credentials to get in.
Yes, I'm very well aware of that, and I don't have them. I've tried.
yeah, they're pretty strict.
They are.
Right. So I actually asked. It was a person who funded the trip is a person who's interested in these two people and wanted to know why one was canonized and the other wasn't, while they were basically contemporaries and did similar types of things. And both were said to have levitated, right? And so there, I decided that by that time, I had come to know Tyler enough to know that he knew a lot about aerial phenomena. And I thought, you know, I'm going to take Tyler with me because it would be really interesting for me to describe some of these events and have him think about them and tell me a little bit about what he knows about aerial phenomena. And plus, you never know what we're going to find, because we're also going to the Vatican Observatory, which is in Castel Gandolfo. And I was an acquaintance of Brother Guy Consolmagno, who's the director, and he had invited me to look at their archive of space research. So I was fascinated to do that. But before we did that, we actually went into the secret archive. Strangely, Tyler got access into the archive, even though he didn't have what I would consider to be the proper credentials.
Well, Tyler also doesn't need to go through the security lines at airports. I've been with him and seen him do that. So he's got a special place in this world. There's no question whatsoever about that.
He's not. Yeah, he's quite an amazing person. So he also befriended a lot of people at the Vatican who were able to get us interviews with people like Father Gumpel, who is a Jesuit, had been a papal advisor for past popes and things like that. So, and we were just able to get a lot of information, let's put it that way, of a wide range of things. And so it occurred to me as we were when you're in Rome, Rome is a very chaotic place and the Vatican is a very special place. There were guards and militia everywhere. I wasn't really comfortable being there. It wasn't a very comforting place to me. And so I didn't think a lot while I was there. I just did the things I had to do. So I looked at the manuscript. I talked to the archivists. I did the kinds of things I was sent there to do. And then when we went to Castel Gandolfo, I sighed because I was like, oh, now I'm in a place where I actually feel, you know, there weren't a lot of people. It was the town was small. I knew Brother Guy, you know, the priests and the brothers there they're all scientists, you know, in academics, and I just kind of breathed a sigh of relief because Rome is a really pretty chaotic place. So when I got there, we were in the archive and we were you know, we're given free rein in the archive to look at all kinds of things, the books by, you know, original books by Kepler and things like that, like really old things. And they had a whole section on extraterrestrial research, which is where I started looking. And it occurred to me at one point that the nun whose manuscripts we just looked at, now these manuscripts were, you know, very old, all in Latin and 17th century Italian. This nun had been flying to a particular place in New Mexico, and it occurred to me, I wonder if she was flying to this very specific place. And so I looked up, really, it just hit me like, you know, like kind of like lightning. And I looked up at Tyler and I asked him, I said, did Sister Maria go to this place in Mexico? Now, of course, I don't know where this place is. And he looked at me, he got this look on his face, and I decided that I wasn't going to ask him any more questions about that. But it was very strange, let's put it that way, whether or not he actually did bilocate there. That I had been to a place near where she believed that she bilocated was really strange to me. And I recognized at that point that my book wasn't in fact done and that this was the last chapter of my book. And so I politely emailed my editor and I said, Oh, can I write one last chapter? And the book was already overdue by months. And she's such a nice editor and very smart and intuitive. And she said, yes. I also sent her some really cool pictures of Rome and Italy. So, so that's what happened.
So let me ask you this. Did you find, what was their ET file like in the Vatican Observatory? What did it have in it? I mean, obviously sure. This, but.
Yes. So it, well, okay. So it, you know, the Vatican Observatory archive and library is basically whatever comes to secret archive in the archive at the Vatican and relates to space or space research goes up to the space archive. And because they just don't have enough room in the other archive. So it goes directly to there. And plus they specialize in space, right? So they're astronomers, astrophysicists, and, you know, they have that specialty. So the part in the archive that is dedicated to extraterrestrial research was about, I'd say it was about 15 feet long by 10 feet high. And it was filled with books about extraterrestrial research from hundreds of years ago until about, Whitley, about the 1980s. And then it just abruptly stopped. And I thought that was odd. So I started back in the day and I looked at a lot of really cool things. I actually found a great book called, it was in German, it was called Wonders in the Sky. And Jacques Vallée had just published his own book called Wonders in the Sky. And I thought, wow, this is just great. And it had a really great cover. Do you remember that? I think I may have sent it to you.
Yes, too. You did.
Yeah, I took a picture
you
of it.
You sent me the cover, yes.
You know? Yeah, and I said, Jacques' book, you know, from hundreds of years ago. And it was really wonderful. It had a big comet on the cover of it. And so, you know, I looked at all of this. And then when I got to the 1980s, I was really interested because from the 1960s on to the 1950s on to the 1980s, a lot of the books, and, you know, I'm doing a cursory look here. I'm not doing, like, in-depth research. I'm just looking at, I'm surveying the territory is what I'm doing because I'm going back there. So I'm surveying the territory to see what people are looking for and at. And there is a lot of discussion from the 50s to the 80s about extraterrestrial intelligent life. And I thought that, and funded research. So we're not talking about, you know, Harvard investigations here. We're talking about grants that are funding this research. And then, Whitley, it just stops. And then what happens is I start to see astrobiology. And, you know, this is how it changes. It gets into the more, you know, we're not looking now for intelligent life. We're now looking for biological life, like microbes and things like that. And that's how it changed. And I thought, well, that's an interesting shift.
Yeah,
in the discourse.
I should say.
Yeah, right there. And so I don't quite understand what it meant, but I took note of it.
Well, free Dreamlanders, take note of these announcements. We'll be right back.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible two-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
We're talking to Diana Walsh Pasulka. Her new book, American Cosmic, UFOs, Religion, and Technology. You can learn more about it at americancosmic.com. But I want to just say this about the book. On a personal level, over the years, I've gleaned, obviously, a lot of information that's probably inside information because the visitors are very close to me and they do tend to let me know whatever I need to know. I have no security clearance. But nevertheless, because of that, I know quite certainly that the people in this book that she has talked to, I don't necessarily know their names, but I know that it's correct. She's saying things that she's learned from them that are quite true and has been taken to a donation site that I've known about for a long time. I don't know either exactly where it is, but it is an important site, and materials have been harvested from it for years. And the strangest thing about it, from what I understand from people who go there, is that there is a tendency to go even years and years later and still find materials, even though the site has been combed to extinction. Why is that, Diana? Do you know? You found materials there.
Yes. I don't know. I mean, I do know that when I got there, it was a very familiar looking place, and the terrain was such that there was materials there that looked like, and in fact, it was confirmed to me that these were cans from the 1950s and 60s that had been strewn for, it looked like about a mile or 2 miles all over the place, and it, through the years, had just crumbled into kind of rust-like rubble, and that was everywhere. And I kept this detail in the book, and my editor asked me about it and said, well, why would you write this? And I said, well, that's what I saw. And she said, well, are you sure you want to keep it in there? And I said, well, yeah, I do want to keep it in there because that's what I saw, and I think it's important. And so I think that it would baffle people who wouldn't understand why that was there, but it wouldn't baffle people who would maybe understand why it was there.
Now, the site is a very interesting one in the sense that it's called the donation site. It's not called a crash site. Why is that?
Well, both the scientists with whom I went referred to it as the donation site. So, and they believed that, whether or not there was an actual crash there, they weren't sure, but they did believe that whatever was there was for us to find. And so James and I were both somewhat suspicious that these things were planted there for us to find. And Tyler wasn't necessarily that suspicious, but we were. And, we're academics, so I guess we're thinking, are we being set up here? And it didn't matter to me whether we were being set up or not, because I was there just to observe and to write about my experiences within these communities of belief. And when we were there, they both referred to it, these as donations. And I think that the idea was that these were provided to us by advanced beings or advanced something. And we could talk about that too, about what provided these things to us so that we could better our own time here on Earth, so that we could make our own species better equipped to deal with either space travel or, the demise of our environment, or, to make things better for us, I think. Or There was also the idea that perhaps it's a Trojan horse. You know, perhaps they're giving us something that is not necessarily benign.
That's always been my worry, because this is a very fraught and complex phenomenon, and it's not clear that it's all sweetness and light at all. What is your impression now that you've actually know some people who work directly in this area? What is your impression of the motives of the visitors, or are there any overriding motives that we could identify?
The more I got into the communities, and so I have two voices. I could speak as, you know, the professor of religion who wrote the book and, you know, sticks with the story in the book, or, and I also have my own opinions, personal opinions that have nothing to do with my university or with Oxford University Press. But from my experience writing the book and being around people who are experiencers, but also scientists who know, who have peer reviewed, you know, articles in the best journals and everything and know what they're talking about. I think that question about what the motivation is perplexing. That's not satisfying, but the more we get into it, the more I see that there are communities, some of whom say, you know, sounding the alarm, saying, wow, you know, we had better be careful. Even Stephen Hawking, who has expressed dismay at people who see UFOs, also has said, we better hope we don't see UFOs because, you know, colonization hasn't gone well, right? Like, you know, meetings of cultures hasn't gone well for the lesson, you know, for another culture. So when, you know, there are two cultures that meet, one generally does wrong to the other. So, and then there are those like Tyler who have incredibly positive experiences with this phenomena and create very, very beneficial technologies that help people. And I've met people who have been helped by the technology, people who can, who didn't, weren't able to walk and now can walk, and, you know, things like that. So
yes,
it's pretty diverse. I think perhaps maybe, you know, if I were to speak off academic speak, you know, I would say the phenomena is pretty diverse and that perhaps there are a variety of these things, you know, phenomena, well, that people experience, some of which are good and some of which don't appear to be.
Yeah. Well, and it's so complex because there's so much of it in my own life. I mean, I've had some of them, they've delivered me some of the most horrible experiences I can imagine. And Anne. And I mean,
yes,
there is a subtext in this experience of losing babies and then being shown a baby later. That happened to us. Annie had a miscarriage one night, and then a few months later, we were shown a baby. And that's hard. That's real hard. And yet at the same time, now I meditate with them every night, and sometimes often during the day, they've worked out a way of communicating with me where they don't have to physically show up, that I understand. And so I'm deeply engaged with them. But, you know, what in the world is going on here that it could be that different on the one hand and on the other? Did you get any impression of that sort of answers to that sort of question from Tyler or James?
So they both do different types of research, and Tyler basically believes that it has to do with, he's a Christian, and he believes that it has to do with uplifting humanity in some way, and he truly believes this, and it's very obvious in his work too. It just, the, you know, the productivity that he is able to accomplish, you know, he's so accomplished and productive, but he's also so positive, like a very positive person. And so he believes that this, that engaging with it is good for humanity. James is interested in looking at how human beings interface with it and the physical structures with which they interface with it. And so that's what his area is. And, you know, he's seen terrible things that have come from it. So again, you know, I'm not presenting one side of the story here. I'm presenting different sides of the experience voices of these different people. Ray Hernandez, I talk about Ray Hernandez, and then his wife also. They both have different interpretations of the same thing that happened to them. They both witnessed the same thing, and they both had completely different interpretations of it.
Exactly. Completely different interpretations. And in my case, I've ended up with both interpretations, or maybe more than one. Have you ever had a contact experience?
I've had lots. Okay. I have had experiences where I have had what appears to be a sighting of something that I can't identify. I don't know what it is. And I had that with my husband, and it was on August 15th, I believe it was 2015. And this was, it was kind of the classic experience for me. And my husband had a completely different experience. My husband being a person who's extremely skeptical, yet, I did see this thing in the sky. I heard an owl, and it was at a place in a time where owls shouldn't be. And I thought, what is an owl doing around here? And everything seemed really surreal and in slow motion. And I saw something sparkling up in the sky, and I looked up, and I thought, no. And then I looked away, and I looked up, and it was still there, almost like it was mocking me. And so I thought, I'm not going to tell my husband because he's a skeptic. Finally, it was there for so long, and I finally tapped on my husband. I said, can you please tell me what that is? And he looked up, and he said, I have no idea what that is. And so we looked at it, and it very slowly, went over, what the distance was, and then it just disappeared. And so that was, and by the way, that was on a very interesting day. It's the August 15th is, I forgot, I should know this, of course, it's a holy day with respect to the Virgin Mary. And that morning I had gone to Catholic Mass, and I had prayed, and I'd asked for strength that day, particularly that day. And so it was a very strange day for me. And a number of strange things happened after that too. I don't know if you know who Mike Cleland is, but he's called the owl guy in UFO circles. And out of the blue, Mike Cleland, then the very next day, if not that day, Skypes me, and we hadn't talked before. And he basically said, I really need to talk with you. And I thought, this is the owl guy. And I suddenly remembered that I had seen an owl before that experience. And then the chair of my department sent me the newspaper, and the newspaper basically said that there were a number of UFO sightings all along the coast where I lived. And I had been the first one to see something. I knew the director of MUFON here in North Carolina, is a very nice woman. And I called her and I said, tell me about this. And she said, oh yeah, there was a huge UFO flap over that whole weekend. And so that's my experience, among other experiences I had. That was the most recent one.
Well, first,
I've not had experiences like you, Whitley.
First, I want to mention, folks, that Mike Cleland will soon have a podcast on unknowncountry.com. As soon as we deploy the new website, oh, great digital masters in the sky, help us. Mike will be podcasting weekly on the website. Very interesting man, and who's had a lot of unusual experiences himself. But I just want to ask you, why did he happen? How is it that he decided to call you, and how did he know you?
Well, you see, that's what's so strange. And that was part of the strangeness of the whole experience, was that I knew of him and he knew of me, but I had never had somebody so directly talk to me like that, just Skype me out of the blue. And not only that, but Jeff Kripal had just sent me a paper that he wrote, and I was incredibly busy doing a lot of work. I had deadlines, I had all these things to do, but I needed to read Jeff's paper. So I opened up Jeff's paper, and this is right before Mike Cleland Skypes me. And this is the day after I have my experience. So I start reading his paper, and it's basically about you, Whitley, and it's about owls. And I'm like, wow, this is really interesting. And then Mike Cleland Skypes me. So it was a very strange, like, multi-day experience.
It's the way it's the way this thing works. This is how the visitors communicate, folks. It's always like this. Well, like last night, I was at a meeting, and for some unknown reason, a book about the relationship between modern science and medieval magic ended up lying on a couch beside me. No one knew how it had gotten there. And so I have it now, and it happens to be very germane to a book I'm writing. So, and you're laughing because we both experienced this. This is the way it is.
Yes. Yeah. It was so much this way that I had to write about it in the book because, you know, I wouldn't have been an honest researcher had I not mentioned it. And so I call it the book encounter, but it's actually about synchronicity and coincidences.
So now at this point in your life, you're working on this book. You are aware now that there is a very real phenomenon going on. You've had actually a sighting experience. And when you're around people like Tyler and James, you tend to become aware of things that you really wouldn't have noticed before. Tell us about how you felt as you realized that this was actually something on some level real.
Yes. So that began to dawn on me, I believe, in a very strong way over the weekend. It actually happened in 2012 when I had attended the UFO conference, and I recognized that there seemed to be, you know, the things that if you look at my CV resume, you'll see that I've written a lot about experiences, religious experiences of people in the past. And so I've written about extraordinary experiences of people in the past. These are all historical things. Nothing that I would say would happen today. We talk and think about religion in ways that are so different today. So I would say these things don't happen. Well, here I was looking at basically all the stuff I'd written about in the past happening to people today. And so I guess that John Mack called this the epistemological shock. So I went through this period of shock, frankly, and this happened to also be when I was working with Chad Hayes and Carrie Hayes on The Conjuring, and I was in this shock, and they have a nose for something kind of interesting, and so they really wanted to know what I was working on because they thought already that the stuff that I was telling them about Catholicism was interesting. And so I thought, gosh, if I tell these guys about UFOs, it's going to be all over, you know? And so I was keeping it close. I wasn't telling them, but I was still working with them. And they were actually, they could sense that I was going through something profoundly life-changing. And in fact, I say there's pre-2012 Diana and post-2012 Diana. So they were engaged with me in 2012 during the time of my epistemological shift. So they then, you know, we would go to dinner and they would say, okay, come on, you know, come clean. What are you studying? So of course I was so fascinated and obsessed with what I was studying. I just told them, I said, look, have you ever thought about UFOs? And they both looked at me in shock, right? So apparently they were experienced, and Christians as well. So after that, it was no going back for those guys. You know, they were like, oh wow, you know, we've got to know. So they wanted to meet some of the people that I was talking to. So they did, and so you can say that what was happening to me was that religion, which was once something that I studied from afar, was something that now permeated my life in a completely real way. And I do write that in the introduction. It was as if I've been studying this my whole life, but I called it religious studies.
And there is an extraordinary connection between religion and the UFO phenomenon that we'll get into in the second hour. But I want to mention now, just in passing, Diana, this, you came to this material and became received a shock from it in 2012. Now, we all know what 2012 was all about. And there was a lot of people who expected all kinds of big, noticeable things. But that's not what happened. Among other things that happened was that the unfolding of this reality became inevitable. And you were chosen, I'm sure, intentionally to play the role in it that you are playing. How do you feel about that? Because I know you to be a deeply Christian person, and I know a lot of other people in this same area are too, but they're not like evangelicals or something. They have a much gentler vision of Christianity. Now, when did you realize that something had happened to you?
Well, you know, it's very ironic the way it unfolded for me, because in 2011, I'm a professor and I have a lot of students, and a lot of my students were concerned that the 2012 apocalypse was going to happen, and they were scared, right? And so I wanted to allay their fears. So I decided that in 2012, I'd teach a class called The Apocalypse, and we would actually read about, you know, we would do primary resource information research on the, you know, the all the stuff related in the Bible about the apocalypse. And we'd learn that, no, there won't be an apocalypse. We're going to be okay. You don't have to be afraid. And what really happened, though, was an apocalypse, which is actually a revelation of things not known.
Yes.
So it was a complete irony for me. So I'm you know, here to say, no apocalypse, everyone. Oh, no, it's not going to happen. And then actually it does happen. Way to me, it happens in 2012. So the irony was not lost on me.
So yeah, so you and I think it happened then for a very deep reason, because behind all of the synchronicities and coincidences that flow when you're becoming engaged with this and are engaged with it is something, call it an intelligence, a consciousness, or simply a way the universe has of putting conscious beings into kind of a state of wonder, I guess it'd best be to call it. Do you have any sense of what that is? In other words, something was calling you. Do you know why? Let me ask a more direct question. Do you have any sense of why?
Well, I do believe that. It's a scary book for me to have written, and because, you know, I'm putting myself out there, and also I'm talking about two very controversial things, religion and UFOs, and I'm basically, and technology, and I'm, you know, connecting some dots here, and I know that it's going to offend a lot of people. So, you know, I know that's going to happen. A lot of people are going to feel a resonance with it too. And I know that's going to happen. So I put it out there because I thought that first we need to understand how, you know, we need to be educated about religion in the first place and how, you know, religion works. And so the processes in which people become religious or interpret events as religious, right? And so I also wanted to point out that our digital environment, our technological environment, is fundamentally changing who and what, not just who we are, but what we are. And so I thought that in many ways, I wanted to articulate that. And it manifests itself as this, the UFO culture, the UFO, you know, the idea of space travel and contact with, you know, with beings that are non-human, but intelligent, non-human beings, basically, that are intelligent. And really, I think that that's what I wanted to say, that it's not a fringe belief, that this is something that's now actually quite pervasive. And so these are the kinds of things that I set out to do in the book. And I believe I accomplished that, to basically show that this is not fringe. This is something that there should be no more John Mack effect, right? We've got like a lot of people studying it.
Yeah, and exactly. And when he died, of course, it was a great loss to that aspect of it, because here he was, a credentialed and tenured Harvard professor and a psychiatrist, studying this seriously, and then suddenly he dies. But now the study is returning. Jeff Kripal is a central figure in this, and
yes.
I'm very glad that he wrote the book Supernatural with me and he's bringing people together, and he's really good at it. So we have a different world now. There are scientists and academics who are taking this all very seriously. Now, do you think that this will aid the eventual revelation of the reality of this, or has it really already happened?
I think that, okay, so this is where, this is a really good question, and I think we have to change the way, see, this is what happened to me in 2012, and I tried to convey it in the book, but it's a difficult idea to convey without being really obscure, which I don't want to be, but I used the philosophy of Martin Heidegger, who's a very obscure philosopher, and he, a lot of philosophers don't even like him because he uses really hard language to understand. Even he makes up his own words in order to try to convey what he, I think he went through a similar experience. He had a spiritual intense experience, and it impacted his philosophy, which had been quite, you know, normal philosophy. And then he became what some called a mystical philosopher. And what happened was that he said there's an era, and it's going to be dominated by technology, and technology won't be something that we use, but we are going to have to understand that we now have a relationship to technology. Now, this is what led me to the work of Jacques Vallée, because Jacques Vallée is one, as you know him very well, who studies the phenomena and has said that the phenomena functions like a technology. And I thought that first it sounded to me like Martin Heidegger, but also in the sense that, you know, a lot of people who do work directly with technology, like even Elon Musk, take Elon Musk, for example, he says that, you know, he's asked about extraterrestrials and he'll say something like, super intelligent digital technology will seem like extraterrestrials to us. So in a sense, you know, we are creating, or is, you know, are we co-creating, you know, super intelligent digital technologies? And even Tyler's work is very strange, because what he's doing is he's introducing technology into the human body and improving it.
Yes, he sure is. And folks, I mean, if you want to know what's where all of the discoveries, and especially in metallurgy and UFOs, are going, into you would be one place when you get a knee transplant or a hip replacement or something. So it's very wonderful on that score. Very wonderful that this is possible
even
and being
you,
done.
Lately, I mean, you have this thing in your ear. I mean, is that not a type of technology?
It is. I know exactly what it is, but it's motile protonaceous cilia that are attached to a metallic base in some unknown way. We know that. And, you know, it used to be that the implant's presence was very mysterious to me, but my listeners already know that I know how to use it, and I've learned to use it, and I've been using it a lot lately, especially because, interestingly enough, I have as much knowledge of this subject as many of people working in the most classified areas of it do because of the implant. If I need to know something, I find it. But here's the interesting thing. We were talking about synchronicity a few minutes ago. That's how the implant works. You ask it for what you need, and then synchronicities occur that deliver that very regularly. It's very reliable. But it is not somebody like talking in your head to you at all.
Well, so it's basically a synchronicity
machine. It's a synchronicity machine. I mean, it's just awesome. Absolutely awesome. And like yesterday, I was sitting around working on the book, and I said, listen, I need help. I'm really struggling, because without Anne here, who was an absolutely brilliant person and so knowledgeable about this that it was extraordinary, and she forgot nothing. I mean, she was really good. I could always bounce things off her, and our books are basically a dialogue. Now, how do I do it? Well, it turns out that after I asked that question, the first thing that happened was the book that I referred to earlier came into my hands out of nowhere. That's how it works. So we have come to the end of the first week with Diana Pasulka. We're going to do this again next week, and we're going to talk about things like whether or not any of the people working on the inside are not just people, but something else, and what that may all mean, and where do we expect this all to go? Is something happening now? So it's going to be a big week next week, and stay tuned for more with Diana Walsh Pasulka. Her book, American Cosmic. Go to AmericanCosmic.com to learn more, or better, buy this and read it, because it is a major event in the history of UFOs and will turn out to be later a major event in the history of the world. So it's really important. Thank you very much for being with us as always.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.